was telling that there are some difficulties with metals for observing the cyclotron resonance. But first of all, let me tell you a few conditions under which cyclotron resonance can actually be observed. Conditions for observing cyclotron resonance is, first of all, your mean free time, that is the time between collisions of the electron, must be pretty long, so that your cyclotron, your electron can actually do a few rounds around the orbit, so that you will be able to see the resonance. Otherwise, you will not be able to see the resonance if the electron gets scattered before completing one orbit of the Fermi surface. So, which means this condition would mean that omega c tau should be greater than 2 pi, okay. Tau is the mean free time or the lifetime of the electron, lifetime in the sense that between collisions, time between collisions, I do not mean anything else. So, that is one condition, and the second condition is the following, that is, if the frequency of the electron, the cyclotron frequency, if omega c is smaller than, let me say, h cross omega c is smaller than the thermal energy, k b t, then what happens is the phonons will scatter the electron away. So, you really have to cool down to very low temperatures. So, you have to cool down to very low temperatures, which means that h cross omega c must be far greater than k b t. So, this implies strong magnetic fields. So, of about 10 tesla. Okay, and this also means that omega c tau should be greater than 2 pi, also is satisfied when you actually cool down to low temperatures. Now, what is the other problem that one faces in metals? In metals, the skin depth is very small. What we mean by skin depth is the depth to which the microwave penetrates in a metal. It is well known in electrical engineering that when you have an AC current, then bulk of the electrons which carry the current are on the surface or close to the surface, and inside the core you do not have any conduction, and that is because the field does not reach the core, and that is but there the frequency is very low, is like 50 hertz or 60 hertz, in which case the depth is not too high, the skin depth is pretty high, I mean. So, this, because of that, you know, is of the order of about 0.03 centimeters or something of that kind, and so that is pretty good for thick enough wires to conduct electricity. Well, here what happens is, supposing I have a material, let us say this is the block, and if I apply an electric field here, then the electric field only goes up to this small skin depth. So, if your magnetic field is perpendicular to the surface, this is the direction of the magnetic field, then the electrons in the bulk are all performing cyclotron motion inside the bulk, and your electromagnetic radiation will never be able to have resonance with the cyclotron motion of the electrons. Asbell and Kaner came up with the idea of having the magnetic field parallel to the surface. So, if you have the bulk like this, and if you apply the magnetic field parallel to the surface, then of course I have the skin depth. So, let me mark the skin depth, and the electrons are performing cyclotron motion in this fashion. Then what happens is that supposing I also have a electric field applied, either parallel to H or perpendicular to H, that it does not matter, either I this way or this way, it does not matter. Then what happens is that if the mean free path is large, then the electron would have performed rotations around orbit of the Fermi surface and will come back frequently up here, and they will absorb electromagnetic radiation if they are in phase with the applied electromagnetic radiation, and then there will be resonance. So, we can have resonant absorption of microwave within the skin depth. So, this people have done experiments using the Asbell-Kaner resonance and have studied the Fermi surface in many materials including metals, and there is pretty good agreement between experiments and band structure calculations. Now let me go to another effect which is involving magnetic field, and which is the de Haussmann-Alphen effect. To know about de Haussmann-Alphen effect, what we should realize is that when a magnetic field is applied, the electron states in the kx ky plane will condense into orbits. So, actually all the electrons which have the same kx squared plus ky squared will be in the orbit, and there are many kx squared plus ky squared constant states, and because of that there are many states which will be degenerate for the cyclotron resonance frequency. Okay? So, let me just give you a picture of how it happens. So, let us look at what happens in a free electron case. In the free electron case, if I look at the k space, I have a whole bunch of kx and ky points, and each one corresponds to some kind of a orbital. If you are a chemist, you can think of it as an orbital, and these will be spread out in k space. Okay, so now when I apply So, this is kx, this is ky. So, when I actually apply a magnetic field, what happens is that in this kx ky plane, the k points which correspond to the same magnitude all will be going around the Fermi surface, and what I get is the following. So, let me try to show it probably on a separate plot, even though it is time consuming. I want to show a sufficient number of orbits so that you have an idea as to what is happening. I have the center here, let me put it in red, and the orbits I can show as extra thin lines. So there will be one orbit which will be going around like that, another orbit which will be going around like that, a third orbit. So this is the L equal to 0, L equal to 1, L equal to 2, etc. So they are all the orbits that you are going to be having in the K space. And of course, you see that these orbits enclose quite a few K points. So what happens, what we can say is that there is a degeneracy associated with each L value. So how do you get this degeneracy? So to get this degeneracy is pretty simple. There are two different ways of doing it. I will do the first one, simpler way one first, and then I will do the next one, the other way, more formal way in the later. So what we have is the area, which I can show you, the area between the two orbits is what I am going to be trying to compute. So if I am looking for the area between the two orbits, then that is given by 2 pi k delta k, because the circumference of the circle multiplied by the distance between the two circles is what is going to give me the area, and I am assuming that delta k is very small. So we also have, I can write down k delta k is equal to delta e m by h cross squared. So this just comes from the dispersion for the free electron, which is h cross squared k squared by 2 m is equal to e. So the area then is going to be given by 2 pi m by h cross squared into delta e. In the K space, number of allowed K points per unit area is Lx Ly by 4 pi square. This is something that we have already discussed before. So because of that, the number of states, in the highlighted region between two circles of different radius is given by Lx Ly by 4 pi squared times 2 m pi by h cross squared times delta E. Delta E is actually equal to a cyclotron frequency h cross omega c, because that is the energy difference between successive quantum states. So I have a number of states in that region is equal to Lx Ly by 4 pi squared times 2 pi m by h squared by 4 pi squared, because I am writing h cross squared explicitly as h squared by 4 pi squared, into e h by m c times h cross, because that is the omega that we had. So what does it give me? This gives me this 4 pi squared cancels this 4 pi squared, and this 2 pi here cancels against the h cross there. So what I have is, this is equal to Lx Ly h, of course this h also cancels against that. So I have E and the M cancels, so I have E by HC. Okay. Now Lx Ly times H is equal to the flux phi of the applied field, because applied field is per unit area, and is Tesla per unit area multiplied by the area will give me Tesla is Weber's per unit area multiplied by meters, area will give me the flux in Weber's. So that I have and E by HC is the basic unit of flux. So what I have, HC by E, sorry, this is phi to the minus 1. So what I have is, this is given by the number of states or the degeneracy psi, which is a degeneracy, is given by phi by phi naught. And we can also have another expression if we do not use phi by phi naught, which is psi h is equal to L by 2 pi squared times 2 pi e by h cross c. This was a heuristic way of calculating the degeneracy. So the number of states, which is psi is the degeneracy of the cyclotron resonance. So what you see is that the degeneracy increases with increasing field, with the increase in applied field. We can also look at this degeneracy, we can obtain it in a different way. We can start with the Hamilton H equal to px squared by 2m plus 1 half m omega c squared into px by m py by m omega c minus x the whole squared. This is a displaced oscillator, as I have already mentioned. And the displacement of the center is by py by m omega c. The center of the oscillator is displaced by py by m omega c. Physical reasoning tells you that the center should lie within the sample. The center of the oscillator should lie inside the sample. So if Lx is the dimensionality along the x direction, what it means is the following: minus Lx by 2 is less than py by m omega c, which is the center, less than Lx by 2. Py is actually given by h cross ky, and ky itself is given by 2 pi n by Ly. So what it means is that the number of allowed states with center inside the sample let us say N or xi, I think we use a symbol xi, we will come back to that one later on, is given by minus Lx by 2. So it just means it is just given by the following, okay. Let me write it down and then I explain to you. So it just means that 2 pi capital N by Ly times m omega c should be maximum is equal to Lx, because Lx is the length, and so if I just shift the origin by Lx by 2, it just means that Py by m omega c must be less than Lx, or Py by m omega c must be equal to Lx, okay. So when the numbers are very large. So what it means is that N is equal to Lx Ly by 2 pi into m omega c, or equal to Lx Ly by 2 pi m into eh by c. So this the m and m will cancel. So the number of states that you are going to be having are just given by Lx Ly by 2 pi into eh by hc. I had a h cross that I missed out, which comes from Py equal to h cross ky, so I should have had a h cross here. So if I had an h cross there, then 2 pi would have gone. That 2 pi would not have existed. So this is what exactly the result that we got before. So this 2 pi is not there. Lx Ly h times eh by nc. Now, what does it all mean? It means the following. Let us say that I am looking at the free electron picture. The energy is going up and I have a free electron picture. And all the states up to EF are occupied. I think now what I will do is, when I apply a magnetic field, say let us say a magnetic field B1, then what could happen is that these will bunch up and they could all be filled also. So if all of them are filled, and essentially there is no change in energy. Now if I apply the magnetic field, if I ramp up the magnetic field to a higher field B1, say less than B2. So in the B2 picture, what will happen is the following. Same is the free electron picture. And what could happen is that I could be having increased degeneracy. Remember the degeneracies are exactly the same in all of them. So I have drawn differently, you know, it appears like the degeneracies of the states are changing, but they are not changing. They are exactly the same for all the cyclotron states. This energy difference is h cross omega c. This is also h cross omega c. And what you will see is that this is the Fermi energy. So only states below that are occupied. So as you ramped up the field, you went to a partly filled upper level because the degeneracy increased. The energy went up because h cross omega c went up. But together with h cross omega c, the degeneracy also went up, because of which the electrons which moved beyond the Fermi surface could fall back into empty levels in the bottom. Now if I have another field which is even stronger, then it will be the following. I have my electrons occupied all the way up to this. This is the free electron picture. Now what happens is I have even bigger degeneracies. So this h cross omega c is much higher, the degeneracy has also gone up, and now again you have come back to the original picture small b1 which was completely filled Landau levels. These are called Landau levels actually. This is b3 and greater than b2, and this is b equal to 0. So what is happening is the following, that is the number of energy levels are keep on increasing, and if I want to find out, you know, in the filled state what the energy picture is, what I have is if L equal to lambda is the highest occupied Landau level, then the number of states occupied is the number of occupied states n is equal to psi h lambda plus 1. So you can actually work it out, it is not so difficult. All you need to do is just a simple arithmetic progression that you will have to just work with. So if you had that, or in other words, 1 by psi times lambda plus 1 by n or 1 by h is equal to psi times lambda plus 1 upon n. Okay, what you are seeing is that there is some periodicity in 1 by h. And in the next lecture, what I will do is I will just give you an introduction to what are the manifestations of this periodicity and what is de Hausmann-Alfvén effect. But right now I will stop at this point, is a convenient point to stop, and we will again resume in the next lecture. Thank you.